Today, we are going to discuss about front-end amplifiers and receiver sensitivity and a quantum limit. So coming to the first one, front-end amplifier, we saw the various sources such as internal noise sources and external noise sources which are in the receiver. And considering those noise sources, we are supposed to design an amplifier which can avoid most of the losses in the receiver. So we try to design the front end amplifiers depending on some factors. So first thing is the noise sources at the front end of a receiver will dominate the sensitivity and the bandwidth. So we require some design of a low noise front end amplifier, because even we amplify any signal using the front end amplifier, it will result in various losses or small amount of noise which gets added into the receiver. So generally we try to maximize the receiver sensitivity and maintain a suitable bandwidth. So that is the idea of having a amplifier. So front end amplifiers are used in optical communication system, and they can be classified into two categories. One is a high impedance amplifier and the other is the trans impedance amplifier. So these are the two designs what we use for the front end amplifiers in an optical receiver. So coming to the first one, high impedance amplifier. So basic concern in this front design or the front end design is a load resistor. So the selection of load resistor is very important in the high impedance amplifier circuit or a design. So we see that here we are going to get the signal which is an optical signal, and this optical signal will be converted into an electrical quantity by the photo detector, which is a photodiode here, and the signal has to be amplified by a front end amplifier. So this is a front end amplifier what we are going to consider, and a proper RL has to be selected in order to avoid noises which occurs in the receiver. So this is a generic structure of low impedance and high impedance amplifier. So this is about a low impedance and high impedance amplifier circuit. So in this we see that the thermal noise is inversely proportional to the load resistance. So this is we know that the thermal noise is inversely proportional to RL. So that we can see that the value of RL can be kept very large so that the thermal noise can be minimized. So while we design this high impedance amplifier, we see that the RL value is chosen very high so that which can avoid or which can minimize the amount of thermal noise. Then for a high impedance amplifier design, which is in this particular diagram, there must be a trade-off between a noise and a receiver bandwidth. So that is a very important topic what we consider under amplification process using an amplifier. There is a presence of noise and it may affect the receiver bandwidth. So there should be a trade-off between a noise and a receiver bandwidth. So we know that the bandwidth is inversely proportional to the resistance, which is seen from the photodiode end. So if I say that the bandwidth is inversely proportional to the resistance, and if I consider the value of resistance is very high, it affects the bandwidth, so that the bandwidth will be very low. So if I say RP is RL for a high impedance front end amplifier, a high load resistance introduces low noise, but that will give a low receiver bandwidth. So if the bandwidth is very low, then the amount of information which can be carried will be very low. So we have to make a trade-off between this bandwidth and the noise. So this is a very important concept what we going to use in the high impedance amplifier design. So we use equalizer sometimes when we implement to increase the bandwidth, and even if the bandwidth is much less than the bit rate, then such a front end amplifier cannot be used. So even though we are using an equalizer to increase the bandwidth, but it may even boost the noise as well, and the bandwidth may be even much lesser than the bit rate, so that such front end amplifier design cannot be used in the receiver. So second is about trans impedance amplifier. So this is a design of or a generic structure of a transimpedance amplifier. So here the conversion from optical to electrical is done using a photodiode and its intensity of the light. And the RL is kept as a feedback resistor in the amplifying process in the front end amplifier. So here this is the design what we are going to consider, so that RL has to be properly chosen to avoid noise, to minimize the amount of noise and to increase the bandwidth. So transimpedance amplifier design is particularly shown like this, and it largely overcomes the drawback of the high impedance amplifier. So in this case, RL is a negative feedback resistor, so this is a negative feedback resistor used around the resulting amplifier. Then the negative feedback resistor RL can be large, so this can be very high, and it can reduce the effective resistance, which can be seen from the photodiode. So this resistance can be reduced when we consider the negative feedback resistor, which can be large enough and with a gain of G, that is a photodiode gain, so that I can say RP is equal to RL divided by G plus 1. Now, for the same resistance, if I consider, the transimpedance bandwidth reduces by a factor G plus 1. So earlier there was an issue with the bandwidth and the resistance. If I increase the resistance, it will affect the bandwidth, so that it may also result in a very small value of thermal noise. But finally, it affects the bandwidth. So here, for the same resistance, the bandwidth reduces by a factor G plus 1. But still, this may increase the thermal noise in comparison with the high impedance amplifier. But it can be a tolerator. It can be tolerated. So the thermal noise what we get using the selection of RL in this design may result in noise, but it will not affect much the bandwidth of the amplifier. So then is a small derivation related to receiver sensitivity. So optical communication system uses a bit error rate value to specify the performance requirements. So whenever I say that the sensitivity of a receiver, or how the receiver is designed, or the performance of a particular receiver, I can measure the performance of a receiver based on the bit error rate. So if the bit error rate is very less, I say that the errors in the receiver is less. But if I say bit error rate is very high, the error in the receiver will be very high. So for example, SONET or SDH network specify that the bit error rate must be 10 power minus 10 or even lower. Whereas gigabit Ethernet and the fiber channel requires a bit error rate not more than 10 power minus 12. So if I consider the bit error rate is very less, then I say that such systems are very good in terms of its performance requirements. Then to achieve a desired bit error rate at a given data rate, a specific minimum average power level or optical level must arrive at the photodetector. So a minimum power level has to be obtained at the photodetector in order to achieve a desired bit error rate of a link. So the value of this minimum power level is called a receiver sensitivity. The minimum power level is receiver sensitivity. So this is the graph which shows the bit error rate as a function of signal to noise ratio when the standard deviations are equal for on and off state of a bit. So a common method of defining the receiver sensitivity is as an optical power receiver, or the average optical power in dBm incident on the photodetector. So that is a common method of defining the receiver sensitivity. So that is giving us an average optical power. So alternatively, it may be defined as an optical modulation amplitude given in terms of peak to peak current at the photodetector output. So the receiver sensitivity gives a measure of the minimum average power which is needed to maintain a maximum bit error rate, or worst case at the specific data rate. So receiver sensitivity should be very good in such a way that the bit error rate is always minimum. So first we are going to express the receiver sensitivity in terms of signal currents from 1 and 0 pulses. So 1 and 0 pulses are represented with the currents I1 and I0 respectively. So signal current I1 represent a pulse 1, signal current I0 represent a pulse 0. And their corresponding noise variations or noise current variations are given as sigma 1 and sigma 0 for 1 and 0 pulses. And we assume that there is no optical power in a 0 pulse. So that is what we assume. There is no, there is absence of power level at the 0 bit, and there is a presence of power level at the 1 bit. So that is what we consider here. And Q represents the receive the quantum limit that is equal to I1 minus I0 by sigma 1 plus sigma 0. So that is equal to I1 minus 0 because I0 is the signal current of a pulse 0, so which is having no power level in it, so that it can be treated as 0. So I1 minus 0 gives us I1 by sigma 1 plus sigma 0. Then the receiver sensitivity, P sensitivity, is found from the average power contained in a bit period for a specific data rate, and that is given as P sensitivity. So sensitivity of this receiver is equal to P1 by 2, which is given by I1 2 times Rm. R represents the responsivity and M represents the gain. So that is equal to Q into sigma 1 plus sigma 0, because I1 is equal to Q times sigma 1 plus sigma 0 divided by 2 Rm. So where R is the unity gain responsivity and M is the gain of the photodiode, what we are using in the photo detector. So if there is no optical power in the fiber transmission link, then thermal noise and short noise are the dominant noise effects in the receiver. So if there is no optical amplifier in the link, then there are other noises which are produced. One is a thermal noise, the other is a short noise. So these two are the dominant noises what we get at the receiver. So the thermal noise is independent of the incoming optical signal power. So but the short noise depends on the received power. So this is what we consider. Thermal noise is independent of the incoming optical signal power, and the short noise depends on the received power. Therefore, assuming there is no optical power in the received zero pulse, the noise variances for 0 and 1 pulses respectively are sigma naught square is equal to sigma t square, and sigma 1 square is equal to sigma t square plus sigma short square. So this is a noise related to thermal, this is a variable related to short noise. So the short noise variance for a pulse 1 is given by this equation, where fm is the photodetector or photodiode noise figure and the electrical bandwidth of the receiver, and it is assumed to be half of the bit rate, which is capital B. So that is BE is equal to B by 2. So considering this, we can get a thermal noise current variance, and thermal noise current variance is given by 4 kgt by RL into FB into B by 2. So this is the thermal noise current, even this is the dominant noise in the receiver. So substituting for sigma 1 and sigma 0 in the equation, and solving for P sensitivity, we get 1 by R into Q by M into this. So this is what we get for sensitivity of the receiver. So that is the derivation for receiver sensitivity. And then we discuss about a quantum limit. So suppose we have an ideal photodetector which has unity quantum efficiency. So there is no loss in the photodetector, not only detection, it always introduces some noise. So that is what we consider. But in this case, we are going to consider a unity quantum efficiency which produces no dark current. So that is, no electron hole pairs are generated in the absence of an optical pulse. So this is how we see the sensitivity in dBm and with respect to bit rate. So we see the difference between the AP diode and the pin photodiode sensitivities with respect to its bit error rate. So in this condition, it is possible to find the minimum received optical power level which is required for a specific bit error rate performance in a digital system. So depending on that, I say that the minimum power level, which is called as a quantum limit. So the minimum received power level is known as a quantum limit, since all the system parameters are assumed ideal. So that is what we consider. There is an ideal case what we consider, and the performance is limited only by the photo detection statistics. We are not considering any other things irrespective of the photo detection process. So assuming that an optical pulse of energy E, which is falling on the photo detector in a time interval tau. So this can be only interpreted by the receiver. So receiver interprets it as zero pulse if there is no electron hole pairs generated. And if there is a presence of electron hole pairs generated, we consider it as a pulse 1. So from the equation what we have discussed, the probability that n is equal to 0 electrons are emitted in a time interval is Pr of 0 is equal to e power minus n bar. So this is how we consider the quantum limit. So where the average number of electron hole pairs is given by n bar, and that is given by n bar is equal to eta by h gamma into integral of 0 to tau pt into dt is equal to eta e by h gamma, that is equal to epsilon lambda into e by h into c. So thus, for a given error probability, that is PR of 0, we find the minimum energy required at a specific wavelength in the quantum limit. So whatever we consider in quantum limit, it is the minimum optical power which is received at the receiver. So that is what we consider as a quantum limit. And depending on the presence of the voltage level, we say that electron hole pairs are generated. And if there is no electron hole pairs generated in the receiver, then we say that it is a receiver where we represent zero pulse with no electron hole pairs generated.